Merry Christmas and Feliz Navidad. If you're a first-time guest, welcome. Be sure to stop by the welcome card in the lobby and say hello. Our welcome team is available to answer any questions you may have and also has a gift for you. We want to personally invite everyone back to our Sunday worship services at 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11 a.m. with our Spanish-speaking worship service at 11 a.m. in Logan Hall. More information is available in your bulletin, so be sure to check it out. At this time, those of you sitting on the right side of the pew, please grab that pew pad, sign your name, and pass it on to your neighbor. When you're finished, leave it open and send it back down your row. Take a look at who's sitting with you and greet them by name a little later.
Celebrate Recovery at New Hope starts on Tuesday, January 7th. Celebrate Recovery is a 12-step Christ-centered recovery program for anyone dealing with a hurt, a habit, or hang-up. While CR is for people battling substance abuse, it is also so much more than that. CR might be right for you if you are dealing with other kinds of addictions, grief, codependency, if you are going through the pain of a divorce or battling depression or anxiety. Here at New Hope, we are also launching The Landing, which will help middle and high school students deal with the very difficult challenges they face. Both programs are intended to help people live emotionally and spiritually healthy lives and gain freedom through Jesus Christ. Both CR and The Landing will take place every Tuesday evening starting January 7th at 6:45 p.m. Because CR and The Landing will be held on Tuesdays, The Table, a dinner church, will also be moving on Tuesdays. Dinner will start at 6 p.m. and our Going Deeper studies will follow immediately afterwards. For more information on Tuesday nights at New Hope, contact Reverend Vicki at vicki@findnewhope.com. Our current mission emphasis focuses on our Zoe Empowerment Group in Zimbabwe. The goal of Zoe is to provide orphans with resources and knowledge so that they will never have to accept charity again. Donations can be made online at findnewhope.com or by placing your donation in the offering plate. Just be sure to write Zoe on the memo line of your check. For more information on what's happening at all of our New Hope campuses, visit us on Facebook or online at findnewhope.com.
Good evening and Merry Christmas. Earlier, we lit the candle of love. We light it and the candles of joy, peace, and hope to remind us of all we need from Jesus Christ. Now, we light the Christ candle, which reminds us that Jesus came to us as a little baby, humble, vulnerable, and needy. God came into the world as one of us. The Bible says, the Word became flesh and lived here on earth among us. He was full of grace and truth. The good news is here. Jesus has come for you and for me. You don't mind, bow your heads and let's pray. Oh God, thank you for Jesus. We stand in awe at the mystery of what this all means. We bow down like the wise men. We sing and rejoice like the angels. And we show up to see what has happened like the shepherds. We celebrate in the name of the one who was born in Bethlehem, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Chris. Good evening again and welcome to New Hope Church. We're thrilled that you're here for this third service with us this evening. We've had two great services already, but you're here with us now. We just want you to know that we hope that you feel welcome and right at home. If you're a guest or a visitor, if you're watching from the web, we hope that you feel right at home with us. And if you're looking for a church home, please prayerfully consider us. We would love to have you be a part of our family of faith. We meet here every Sunday. Three times, 8, 9, 30, and 11, and something there for everybody. So we'd love to have you come and be a part of that with us. One of the things that we like to do is make sure that you get involved and be a part, anticipate, engage with us in the worship service. So this is the time of the year that you're going to get to sing at least three carols with us, and we're going to begin with two that are upbeat and then Silent Night a little later. So we always like for everybody to feel right at home and welcome and at ease. One of the things that helps us with that, if you'll just stand and shake hands with somebody around you and just say good evening or Merry Christmas, tonight would be a good thing, all right? And then we want you to sing Joy to the World at the top of your lungs with us.
Receive a gift, let everyone prepare.
Thank you for singing so well. Bless you. You may be seated.
Merry Christmas. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Holy God, how wonderful it is to come before you this evening and celebrate Christmas Eve. God, we are so thankful for the coming of your Son, for Emmanuel, God with us, because it meant and it means that we can be reconciled to a holy God, and that you aren't far from us somewhere out there, that you are right here, and we can walk hand in hand with you, and we are so grateful for that. God, I lift up everybody here. We know for some, Christmas is a time of joy and excitement, and for others, it's a time of sorrow and sadness. And so I just pray that whatever feelings that people might be experiencing, that they will know that you are with them, that the Holy God is with them. And I just pray that you make your presence known in a really powerful way. Oh God, we're so thankful for who you are, for all you do, and for the ways that you are still working in our lives. We give you all the glory and praise. Amen. In our offering tonight, all the loose plate offering is going to one of our mission partners, Zoe Empowers. And Chris mentioned it in the announcement, but Zoe is a phenomenal organization that works with orphans in various countries in Africa and India. We have an empowerment group in Zimbabwe, and they learn all kinds of wonderful skills. They learn about Jesus, and it teaches them how to never experience, have to accept charity again and experience true physical, emotional, and spiritual freedom. So would the ushers come forward so we may receive our ushering, our offerings for this tonight.
Thank you. wait.
Okay. Now, imagine that you're all alone.
It's really quiet.
And kind of dark, but then...
lights loose.
Bull beat. So bright, you blink and jump back. That's when the angel Gabriel shows up to see Mary. Gabriel says,
"Don't be afraid. You're going to have a baby. God's son.
Call him
Jesus.
But right before Mary's about to have the baby, her and Joseph have to travel to a faraway town called Bethlehem.
Picture the trip. You're riding on a donkey, and the dust gets kicked up.
When Mary and Joe finally get to Bethlehem, the whole town is so loud and crowded, there's no place for them. But at last, they find a room where the animals stay.
It's kind of warm and cozy, even though the hay scratches and the place smells. Ugh.
And then you hear the baby.
A brand new baby.
Baby Jesus is seeing the whole wide world for the very first time.
Mary wraps Jesus up tight and lays him on soft hay in the cow's feeding trough.
Sleep, my child, in peace, attend thee all through the night.
Estrellita, donde estás?
Uri, aquí, chaldo, chanda.
Picture a big open field outside Bethlehem. Sheep everywhere, like big fluffy cotton balls. You gaze up at the deep, dark sky.
Then light flashes and a huge, bright angel appears. The huge angel calls out, "Don't be afraid. I've got good news. God sent a baby to save everyone. He's in Bethlehem. You'll find him wrapped in cloth and lying in a manger."
And more angels appear. They're singing.
Gloria a Dios a las alturas.
Glory to God in the highest. The shepherds race to find Jesus in Bethlehem. They're filled with so much joy that they have to go share.
But they're not the only ones that show up.
You look up high. There it is, the star.
Gubbiol.
La estrella.
These wise men have been following that star for months.
Riding high on a camel's back, and it bumps and sways and spits too.
Ew.
Ew.
And when they show up, they give him gifts.
Gold,
frankincense,
and myrrh, stuff you give a king. And just like the shepherds, the wise men get down and worship Jesus, this little kid who's actually God's son.
This little kid who's come to save the whole wide world.
You and me.
Tú y yo.
Noranda.
You and me.
I'm not crying, you're crying. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for the beauty of this amazing story. And we pray, God, that you'd help each person hear exactly what you need them to hear tonight, regardless of the words that come out of my mouth, and help me get out of the way so you can come and truly be the way, the truth, and the life in the lives of those who are gathered here tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Welcome. Many of you are visitors from afar. You've come from out of town, and we're grateful for your presence. Some of you right now, you're watching online, and I want to say welcome to you as well. Some of you have been members of this church for 50 years, and you live three blocks away. No matter what got you here, we're glad you're here. One of the things I loved about the prayer that Reverend Vicki gave was it was a reminder that each one of us comes in with different things on a night like tonight. Some people are hurting, and other people are filled with great and abundant joy. No matter what, we want to know that we're with you. Romans 12:15, the Apostle Paul said that our job as Christ followers is to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep. So we do both together, and not one without the other, and it's an important part to recognize whatever it is and wherever you're at tonight. So whatever you're experiencing, whoever brought you here tonight, how many of you have a pretty good idea what the message is going to be about? I think most of you probably do. You just saw it. It was lifted up in the scripture. That's Luke chapter 2, along with Matthew chapter 2, with the wise men added into the story. This is my 34th Christmas since becoming a pastor, and I still have to remind myself every single year that people are so well aware of the story of Jesus' birth, but that doesn't mean that I have to try and get real crazy and different and spice it up too much. I spice things up in my food all the time. I love sriracha sauce. And in fact, I love it so much, I slather it on my food before I taste it, which drives Denise, my wife, up a wall. The reality for us is that this is not a holiday that needs spicing up. Remember, a number of years ago at a previous church, I had an assistant minister who he decided that he would spice up baptisms for us. Now, he had a really good reason for this. He wanted to be creative. He wanted to reach young families, and we didn't have very many young families in the church. And so he had this really wonderful and creative idea. He went out to antique stores, and he got antique pitchers and bowls. And so whenever a family brought an infant for baptism, we did their baptism in this pitcher and bowl, and then we gave it to them as a gift. And we said, whenever you look at this, remember your child's baptism. And then when they go off and they leave and go to college or go off on their own, give them the bowl and pitcher so that they'll remember their baptism. I thought, what a beautiful, wonderful idea. And then what he also did was he mixed three different kinds of water together. First, he took just regular water from the tap at the church to represent the body of Christ, this family of faith. And then he took also some water from the Caloosahatchee River to represent the region that we were called to serve. And then he also threw in some water from the Jordan River. And I was just there a couple months back and got to remember my baptism with a lot of people from our church. But when he put the water from the Jordan River in where Jesus was baptized, he'd always give that little emerald move and he'd go, bam, like he's really spicing up the water, you know. And it was a wonderful, fun, and creative way to remind people about how important something was. But the reality is the Christmas story doesn't need spicing up, does it? The Christmas story speaks quite well for itself. The reality is that the truth of God's word is always more than enough on its own. How many of you have family traditions that are unique, maybe odd, or different than just the norm, but they're unique to your family? I mean, if you're looking around at your family members, you have one of these. And I don't mean the stuff that almost every family does. I mean the things that are kind of unique and different that have arisen, and you're not even sure sometimes how they got there. Like, for instance, my brother, he would wrap gifts in comics, so he would have to save the Sunday comics for weeks so that's what he'd wrap his gifts in. He's 60 years old. He still does that sometimes. One of the traditions in my family is that at Christmas, we have shrimp cocktail. And no one has a clue where that came from. We were discussing it recently. It was like, how did we discover that? I mean, this doesn't make any sense that we began to do that. One family tradition that died a natural and well-deserved death was the dreaded aluminum Christmas tree from the 1960s. I mean, this was an atrocity. We're really great. See that little light on the bottom there? I was captivated by that thing as a kid. I loved that little light. It is so low tech and so silly. And it's like, but I would sit there and I would just look at the way that it would glow on the aluminum tree and just delight in that as a child. It's pretty lame by today's standards. I had the tradition of every year I would give my grandmother the gift of chocolate-covered cherries. And it was like, it was just this wonderful little thing that we did. It was a unique tradition. And then when I was 21 years old, my grandmother pulled me aside away from everyone else, and she said, "Jamie, I love you. I hate chocolate-covered cherries." hate them. And I said, oh, I guess I've arrived at the age of gift accountability, that it's okay to tell me now that you don't want these anymore. And that was good. It was good that she was able to say, don't do this anymore. Maybe you have some fun tradition in your family that's related to Christmas, or maybe you could create one together this year that makes a difference and is meaningful to you. Have you ever, as a family, hidden clues around the house to where the gifts might be found? That was one of the things my family did when we were growing up, is you'd have to have a little adventure to find your gift. I am so glad that God the Father didn't merely hide clues for us to find Him, but He gave us the best gift in Jesus, and He made it abundantly clear. He sent Jesus Christ into this world to reveal the fullness of His nature to us. And think about this. The Father chose not to hide, but He came into the world at a specific time, in a specific place, in a specific person, Jesus. John chapter 1, verse 14 says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 and 19 says, "He, Christ, is the visible image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in Him all the fullness," not a little bit of the fullness, not some of the fullness, not most of the fullness, "but all of the fullness of God was pleased to dwell." Man, you don't need to spice that up. That's good enough right there. And a key part of the Christmas story is that this one who is the Word made flesh, this one who is the visible image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, is that God thought that it was so important to put His very own Son into a human family. I mean, think about that. I mean, how powerful is it that God the Father entrusted His very own Son to a mother and father in Joseph and Mary? Profound, deep. I mean, that's like, you got to think about that for a long time. Now, I know that we just heard the story told on the video from Luke chapter 2 and Matthew 2, but I want to encourage you that maybe one of the great family traditions for you to begin would be to read the Christmas story together as a family, or read it in a fun way like that before you open your presents, just as a way to remember who the ultimate present is, Jesus Christ. And that's a good, good thing. Now, here's the thing. In the first century, there was a guy by the name of Luke who decided that it was going to be really important for him to put together and order and accurately the account of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, so that people in that generation and every generation to follow would come to know the truth of what had happened. In fact, he even tells us that in the very beginning of his gospel, his good news, in Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. He says, "Many people have set out to write an account about events that have been fulfilled among us. They used eyewitness reports circulating among us from the early disciples. Having carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I also have decided to write an accurate account for you, most honorable Theophilus." Like, that's a great name. Theophilus, you know what it means? Lover of God. So you know who the letter is directed to? You. Why? Because God calls us to love Him. We're lovers of God. It's a good thing. Oh, Theophilus. So you can be, what? Certain of the truth of everything you were taught. So Luke doesn't start out and say, once upon a time. Luke doesn't say, in a galaxy far, far away. Right? He says, here, he says, guess what? I've talked to everybody. I've talked to all kinds of eyewitnesses. I've examined the data. And guess what? I talked to people who saw all this with their own eyes. I'm not telling you fantasy. I'm not giving you science fiction. I'm giving you the absolute truth, the facts. And so in Luke's account of the Christmas story, we find this picture of God as distant and unmoving, completely shattered, as God enters into human history, into the mess and the muck of what it's like to be you and me. And God arrives in the most humble way imaginable. And think about it. God the Father entrusted and he placed Jesus with this incredibly poor family, this mom and dad. And Jesus needed them. God in the flesh needed Mary and Joseph. He came into the world weak and needy and nursing and crying. We say that God in Jesus, the visible image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, needed to have his diaper changed. I want you to think about how radical and crazy that sounds. That doesn't need any spicing up. I mean, the radical message of Christmas is God showing up in Jesus where people least expected to find God and least expected to experience the good news. And the word gospel literally means good news. So that's what Luke was writing. That's what he's writing about. Now, the first person to coin the term good news was the Roman Emperor Caesar Augustus. And Caesar Augustus has a role in the Christmas story, doesn't he? Caesar Augustus said, "I am the good news." In other words, he was saying, "I am God. I am the gospel. I am the one that you are looking for." And he declared himself to be that. Verse 1 of chapter 2 of Luke's gospel says, "In those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered." Luke was declaring, nope. No, this guy who says he is the good news, he ain't good news. Jesus is the good news. And don't ever forget that. The real good news is in the Son of God. And the Son of God who is promised to us is not Caesar Augustus in mighty Rome, but is Jesus who is born in insignificant and powerless Bethlehem. The Son of God showed up not wrapped in royal robes, but wrapped in strips of cloth. The Son of God was not surrounded by great wealth, but extreme poverty. The Son of God was not surrounded by earthly power, but was frail and vulnerable. The Son of God was not found among the elites of the world. Rather, the Son of God was found among the third shift shepherds and farm animals. And while we often travel to be with family at Christmas time, Luke made it clear, while Joseph and Mary did have to travel, they had to make a 120-mile journey on donkey to go to Joseph's ancestral home. It wasn't for a family reunion. It was because Caesar Augustus said, "You will be counted. You will pay the taxes." And the one who said, "I am the good news," demanded that they make the journey. But here's the thing. That fit right into God's plan. It was a fulfillment of an Old Testament prophecy in Micah chapter 5, verse 2, which 400 years earlier had proclaimed, "But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, are only a small village among all the people of Judah. Yet the ruler of Israel, whose origins are in the distant past, will come from you on my behalf." And not only was Bethlehem, Bethlehem means house of bread. So think about that. Jesus born in the house of bread. And he later on said, "I am the bread of life." And so the one who is born in the manger, the feeding trough, is the one who wants to feed us. He wants to offer his life as nourishment in our life. And it's like the thing about Bethlehem is it's not only small and insignificant, but the houses there were small and insignificant at the time. 1- and 2-room homes. And so there's a problem with the translation when we talk about there being no room in the inn. I remember when I was a teenager, we did a live nativity play, and I played the innkeeper, and I played it to the hilt as mean as I could. I rejected Mary and Joseph and sent them packing. And that's not the right picture to have, because it's not like there was a room in the Hilton or the La Quinta that they were being turned away from. There was just no more room for additional guests, given how many people had shown up in Bethlehem. All the families had to show up. In other words, Joseph's family had no more room for any more family members when he and Mary arrived. They went to Bethlehem knowing that they were going to stay with family, people who they knew would take them in, and those people gave them the best place available. So they went to the best place available, a warm cave nearby where the animals stayed. This is the place where they believe that Jesus was born. They built a church over the top of it. This is the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. And if you reach your hand into that little hole on the floor, you touch the cave where they believed that Jesus was born. And actually, that was a normal place for a very poor baby to be born. But it was a lousy place to think about a king being born. Luke, in creating this orderly and accurate account for all generations, knows the remarkable, utterly preposterous, yet utterly true story points to the rest of Jesus' story. I mean, I want you to think about this. We can never escape the truth that the cross looms large over the manger. This one who is born to seek and save the lost and reveal the love of his Father will ultimately do so through his death on the cross. I mean, the wise men came with gifts for the king, right? They came with gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and a key ingredient in the mixture of spices that was used to prepare a body for burial. That's myrrh. So the wise men, they brought a gift for Jesus that was about preparing his body for burial. The angels announced this incredible good news for all people that had arrived to this group of insignificant shepherds. The good news was not that a political figure named Caesar Augustus, as he declared himself to the world. Rather, the good news was simply a baby, God in the flesh, who would be found with an insignificant couple in an insignificant place in the best, really bad conditions available, but still wildly unacceptable for a king. And we stand in awe of the mystery of what Christmas means. We sing and we rejoice like the angels. We show up to see what has happened like the shepherds. We bow down in worship like the wise men. So you can see why this story is so incredibly shocking. To find God in human form in this place at this time with these shepherds and all these animals around. And God is always surprising us with the gift of Jesus. He surprises us with the way that he came into the world. He surprises us tonight, wants to surprise us. At Bethlehem, in Jesus' birth, we say something incredible. God is with us. On the cross, in his death, we say something incredible. Jesus is God for us in our suffering. At Easter, in his resurrection, we say Jesus is God of victory over sin, suffering, and death. And on Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit comes, we say that this means that God has made a home in me forever. And I am grateful for his presence in my life always. And so we are grateful that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And so here we are, 2,000 years later, proclaiming and celebrating with the angels, not that Caesar Augustus matters at all, not that any political figure could ever be genuinely good news. Why? Because Jesus alone is the good news. The Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9:15, talking about who Jesus is, he says, "Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift." Isn't it great to know that you've been given an indescribable gift? We celebrate tonight this incredible, awesome, over-the-top gift of the Word made flesh and dwelling among us, of the firstborn of all creation, of the visible image of the invisible God. And if God showed up as a baby to an insignificant couple in an insignificant place at a specific time in history, he can show up anywhere and anytime for you as well, to be your good news and the gift that you need the absolute most. So why not tonight? Why not to you? In response to the Father, the gift of his Son is to us. What What is God wants most from you? Guess what? What he wants most from you is you. Put a bow on yourself and be a gift back to Jesus. He wants you to respond faithfully and obediently to his grace and his love offered freely to you. And here's the problem. The problem is that when someone gives us a gift, we have an option about how we'll receive it. The reality is, if you receive a gift and you don't open it and you put it on the shelf, have you actually received the gift? Nope. You don't even know what's inside of it. You're not even exploring the gift. Or sometimes what you can also do is you can open the gift, see, wow, this is a really good gift. This is going to go in my regifting pile. Okay? All right? Now, see, what that means is you've decided this is a worthwhile good gift. I like this gift, but I don't, but not for me. That's good for somebody else. You know somebody that's done that with Jesus, don't you? Another thing that we can do with the gift is simply reject it altogether. I know that Denise, my wife, she used to deliver flowers, and she got to see the joy and the pain of the gift of the flowers all the time, because, you know, usually she's delivering to somebody who's experienced great sadness at a funeral or great joy for a wedding or an anniversary. And one time she delivered flowers to a woman who immediately threw the dozen roses into the garbage. It was a gift that was too little too late in that relationship. So the gift was delivered, but it was not received. Could that be the way that you responded to Jesus? You know the gift, but you haven't fully embraced it. You haven't said yes to it. Please say yes tonight to Jesus if it's for the first time or the 50th. Because you know what? No matter how long you've been following Jesus, there's always a time of renewal that is necessary. There's always a time of recommitment. And so I want to submit to you, what we can best do in the gift of Jesus is receive it with incredible joy and say, thanks be to God for this indescribable gift of grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone. And when we receive that gift, we have the privilege of spending the rest of our lifetimes learning how to best glorify God and enjoy Him forever and ever and ever. And Jesus is the best free gift we'll ever be offered. But we have to say yes. And we have to receive Him. Jesus is the visible image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn of all creation. Jesus Christ is the one who has been born for each one of us. He is the Word become flesh and dwelling among us. That doesn't need any spice. Let's pray. Dear God, we are abundantly grateful for your presence here tonight. I want to thank you for the way that you entered into the world, that yes, you lived, you died, you were resurrected on our behalf, you offered yourself freely for us that we might experience it, you became God with skin on so that we could say yes, and that you came to fully reveal the reality of the Father. You didn't come to hide. You came to be revealed. And so I thank you that you are the full expression of love, and that you are that for me, and that you are that for each person here tonight. Help us joyfully live every day in response to your incredible gift of salvation. Amen. As we prepare to light our candles, I want to remind you that you want to hold your unlit candle and dip it into the lit candle, okay? Otherwise, you're going to have wax all over everything, and that's not a good idea. John 8, chapter 12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world, and the light of the world shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it, cannot extinguish it. Just a little bit of light pierces everything, all of our darkness. If we walk in the light, the darkness can never have the last word.
Silent night, O night divine. Christ is born, and the hope and joy are given to us. This is a gift for us, God with us. Let us go from this place proclaiming that we have seen the glory of God, believing that there is a light that shines in the darkness, which the darkness shall never overcome. And may the love of the Creator, the joy of the Spirit, and the peace of the Christ child be with you this Christmas and every day evermore. Joy to the world. Merry Christmas. God bless you.
Do you remember me?